asparagus held by a dog. But this is not what it seems. It's actually edible, part of a packed lunch. The motif is a Japanese fairy tale character, Isunboshi, who stood just 3 centimeters high and traveled around in a bowl. Known as bento, Japanese packed lunches typically contain a colorful variety of foods arranged inside a small box. The more beautiful the presentation, the more it's a sign of love for the person who's going to eat it. Established restaurants have also begun offering meals based on the bento approach. This is a recent development in the long tradition of Japanese cuisine. Bento originated as simple packed meals carried by travelers. But over the centuries, they have become more and more elaborate. These days, bento have become edible canvases that showcase the skill and imagination of their creators. In this edition of Begin Japanology, we explore the history and the aesthetic of the bento.
Welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. This week our theme is bento, Japan's ubiquitous lunchbox. I'm standing in the food department of a department store in Kyoto, and as you can probably see around me, there are all different kinds of bento already on sale, although the shop's just opened. This shop next to me has a section here of bento that are specially recommended for lunchtime. This is a special for the day, which is a hamburger made out of tofu. That's the central ingredient. And then there's a whole range here of bento that are particularly popular at this shop. As you can see, they're all extremely colourful, and each bento includes a range of different kinds of food. We've come in early today to avoid the crush, because within a short time these aisles will be full of office workers and even housewives who come in here to buy their bento. There's an enormous variety of different styles of boxed lunches that people buy, and they're all very popular. We'll be looking at some in detail during the course of the show, but before we do that, let's take a look at how this phenomenon got started in the first place.
Lunchtime at a kindergarten. Each of the children has a homemade bento to tuck into. Anything that you carry with you to eat when you're away from home can be called a bento. It's a way of eating, and this is an essential part of Japanese lifestyle. There are also many shops that sell bento. Convenience store chains are constantly developing new varieties, and often see a significant spike in the number of customers when they come up with a bento that's particularly popular. These days, annual sales of bento are worth some 6 trillion yen. That's about 60 billion US dollars. Whether you carry your own homemade bento or buy one in a shop, there's a huge range of styles and ingredients. But how did this phenomenon start? To find out, we have to look way back into Japan's history. The earliest form of portable food, rice known as karei, appeared between the 6th and 8th centuries. This is often called a forerunner of the bento. People began carrying dried grains of glutinous rice, which they would reconstitute by soaking in water, either cold or hot, to make it soft enough to eat. Rice is a staple food in Japan. It has long been an important source of energy for people as they travelled. Eventually, the karei was superseded by nigiri meshi, cooked rice formed into balls. This formed the basis of the bento. The rice grown in Japan is sticky when it's cooked, so it's easy to form into balls that can be carried around. This was highly convenient for people travelling for work or for war. The start of the Edo period, about 400 years ago, ushered in an era of peace and prosperity. ordinary people began going on leisure trips around the country, and this led to a big evolution in bento. The 19th century woodblock print shows an outdoor picnic under the cherry blossoms. It was common to carry food in bento boxes for parties like this. This is what a bento for a blossom-viewing party would have looked like. It contains a variety of foods considered luxuries in those days. Red sea bream, sweetened Japanese apricots, bracken ferns, ijiki seaweed, and other delicacies. Following the Chinese tradition, foods that were red, yellow, green, white, or black were all included. This colorful variety was not only to make the bento look appetizing, it provided sound nutritional balance. Bento sets like these were known as oju, and were very luxurious, often even including a flask that would hold sake. Drawers were fitted that could hold small plates. Everything needed for an enjoyable excursion. Owning a bento set like this was a major status symbol in those days. The kabuki theater became more and more popular from the 18th century. Because performances could last an entire day, theatre started providing hungry audiences with ready-made meals in bento boxes. Since they were eaten during intermissions, they came to be known as maku no uchi, or between acts bento. They would include a wide variety of ingredients, such as grilled rice balls, omelette, slices of fish paste, and broiled tofu. Usually people ate very simply, so it was a treat for audiences to dine on luxurious makanouchi bento at kabuki performances. Even today, bento featuring a great variety of prepared foods are called makanouchi bento. In the old days, the word signified a celebratory event. That tradition has been carefully preserved to the present day. Leaving behind their daily routines, people would set off to have a fun day out. This led to the creation of many different types of bento in Japan.
This time of year, the blossoms are really pretty. These are all ume, which is usually translated as Japanese apricot. All different shades between white to very pale pink to these deeper pink shades here. And when these blossoms come out, you know that the cold of winter is just about gone and spring is right around the corner. And of course, when they see the blossoms, Japanese people will go out to view them and have viewing parties as well. Parties means food, drink, and of course, bento. We saw in the video just now that the roots of bento were in the act of staving off hunger back in the days when making even a fairly short trip was a major undertaking. These days, though, of course, the bento has become an indispensable part of any outdoor meal. I've got my own bento here today, and it's wrapped in one of these beautiful furoshiki carrying cloths. I don't know what's in this yet. Before we do find out, let's have a look at another video now to show you the immense variety of different kinds of food that you'll find in a bento box.
Part of the enjoyment of any journey by train is choosing a bento to eat while you're on the move. The bento sold at stations are called ekiben. Each area, and even each individual station, is likely to have its own speciality. Often the packaging and the box itself will have a distinctive design. Kids love this ekiben, which comes in a container shaped like a Shinkansen bullet train. It's filled with the sort of food that appeal to children, such as spaghetti and mini hamburger patties. There's plenty of pork meat in this bento, and it's sold in a pig-shaped container. It comes with a lid that has a slot in it, so when you've eaten the food, it has another use as a piggy bank. Kamameshi is a way of cooking rice with vegetables or meat. This bento features sliced bamboo shoot, shiitake mushrooms, and other specialities from the mountains. The ceramic container can be taken home and reused for cooking rice. It's not just the containers that make bento so distinctive. Often they are given evocative names. This This one is called Iso no Isaribi, referring to the fires that are carried on fishing boats to attract squid or other fish. It contains a variety of seafood, such as turban shell clams, deep-fried prawns, and herring wrapped in seaweed. This one is called the 21st Century Shutsujin Bento. Shutsujin means setting out for war. Konnyaku jelly is shaped like the flags carried by samurai. Chestnuts were considered lucky in fighting. And sea snails represent the conch horns that were blown during battle. The name was coined to evoke the sense of setting out to face the new century. The name of this bento, Eppin-san, refers to a beautiful woman. It contains healthy, low-calorie foods such as tofu and vegetables. So it conveys the sense of becoming both beautiful and slender. Purple pickles and green mange tout peas are arranged to form a flower shape. This ingenuity is not just restricted to bento sold in shops. Homemade bento also offer plenty of scope for creativity. Using a cutter in the shape of a cherry blossom, you can cut kamaboko fish paste or ham into petal-shaped pieces. Arranged over rice, this gives a bento the perfect springtime accent. The sausage octopus is always a hit with children. The sausage is split open and grilled, so it takes the shape of an octopus with its tentacles curled up. Boiled eggs are more attractive if they're cut with a jagged edge. Slicing cucumbers in different ways makes them look more interesting. Homemade bento are full of little flourishes that add enjoyment to the eating experience. Some people like to show off their bento designs. Miyazawa Mari takes photographs of the many bento she makes for her family, and she creates an exhibition periodically. Her remarkably creative bento are hugely popular, and every day her website gets more than 3,500 hits. She made this bento for her husband, after he'd been getting home late several nights in a row after going out drinking. Made with seaweed and eggs, the central motif is an angry-looking bird. This tongue-in-cheek bento design was a way for Miyazawa to express her frustration. Here is a bento she created ahead of a school sports day. It was made to encourage the children to do their best in the relay race. The faces are made of ham, and the hats are composed of carrot and fried egg white. I think you can really communicate through bento. The changing seasons. Things you notice around town. Little discoveries. All these things can be incorporated into a bento that you can share with your family. The names, the ingredients, and the design. All these are important elements in preparing a bento. It's become a medium of communication. A way for the creator to express his or her feelings for the person who will eat it.
Well, as you can see, bento come in all kinds of different containers. What's inside is an incredible variety as well. And they even get given some interesting names. I wonder what I've got in here. I think it's time to open it up now. And this furoshiki is absolutely beautiful as well. Very seasonal looking too. Very spring-like. And I suspect, or rather expect, that what's inside will be spring-like as well. And there we go. Wow, that's very nice indeed. It's a double-tiered box. Well, we've got the five colours that you have to have. There has to be red, yellow, green, plus black and white. And we've got all of those. And some lovely shapes too. Look, those little carrots have been cut into the shape of cherry blossoms. And this kamaboko, the fish cake, has been cut and then knotted into a sort of rather organic, almost like a little petal or something. There's some asparagus here. We've got the yellow of the omelette there. This is a prawn down here, some pink. These are nanohana, mustard greens. Above those here in the top, that's bamboo shoot. We have some fish here, I think that's kind of mackerel with a little tiny slice of lemon on the top. So, as you can see, all the colours and different shapes and everything very seasonal too. And here in the bottom, basically the rice, but we have some pickled cherry blossoms. Yes, cherry blossoms in here as well, just to give it that extra seasonality. And my bento has been given a name as well. In Japanese, it's ume no kaori, which means scent of apricot. Now, looking at this, I'm sure you've noticed how wonderful the food looks, but you may have also noticed that the container itself is rather refined looking. And next we're going to have a look at how these boxes are made.
The growing popularity of bento has led to the creation of many kinds of containers with ingenious designs. There is one type of bento box that was commonly used by ordinary people back in the old days. Now it's become highly prized as a traditional handicraft. Called wappa or mempa, it's made of wood such as cedar or cypress. There's a long tradition in Japan of using wood as a material, both for houses and utensils. That same know-how has been harnessed to produce bento boxes as well. Tsuchikawa Masami is a craftsman who creates containers, including bento boxes. His family has been doing this for four generations. He uses high-quality cypress wood grown locally. A thin band of wood is soaked in hot water to soften it, and then it's formed around a mold. This curves the wood into the desired shape. Any mistake at this stage will mean the bento box will not have a tight fit later on. A strip of cherry bark holds the curved wood together. This bark is strong and it's also very attractive, just right for the job. Wappa boxes soak up any excess moisture from the cooked rice. This means the rice doesn't get too sticky and retains its flavour. Everything depends on the skill of the craftsman. The slightest mistake means the beautiful box may not fit perfectly. Long experience is needed to produce these wooden boxes. Traditional boxes are being made all over Japan. In Akita Prefecture, cedar wood is the preferred material. Sometimes the inside of the box is coated with lacquer to add a distinctive finishing touch. Natural lacquer is used, derived from tree sap. Treating the wood this way not only gives the box a more attractive look, it also makes it more durable. Because lacquer breathes, it still allows the wood of the bento box to adjust to the moisture in the food. This type of bento box is the product of the craftsman's skill in combining natural materials such as wood and lacquer. It's simple, but it's perfect for transporting the delicious food arrayed inside.
And my bento box was made by exactly the same craftsman that you've just seen in the video. And as I said before, it's a two-layered box. The top part fits perfectly into the bottom part here. So you can see it's really superior craftsmanship, and it's been sewn together, as you saw in the video, using cherry tree bark. And There you go, the lid fits on like that. Now, another interesting thing is that this top part in which the cooked food is put is lacquered, and the bottom part isn't. Now, the reason for this is that when you have cooked food, it's likely to have juices or other elements which are possibly going to stain the wood. So the lacquer prevents that from happening. And again, the lacquer's in the lid as well. If you look in the bottom half, you'll see that there's no lacquer here. And the reason for this is that cedar wood from which this box is made has a beautiful fragrance to it. Absolutely gorgeous. And of course you don't stick your nose straight into the box, but when you're eating the rice, you do get a faint sense of that fragrance, and it makes the rice even more tasty. So as you can see, the whole thing's really very well thought out. As we've seen, bentō developed as a way of eating outdoors without compromising the quality of the food at all. Now, over the past several decades, what's happened is that a separate culture of bentō, intended from the start to be eaten indoors, have begun to appear in some Japanese restaurants.
Bentō were developed so that people could carry cooked food when they were traveling, with a variety of ingredients packed into a single container. But in the middle of the 20th century, a different style of bentō emerged. This restaurant, in the Fushimi district of Kyoto, serves traditional kaiseki cuisine. It's been in business for 250 years. The owner, Araki Shigeo, offers a less formal version of the kaiseki meal served bentō style. It doesn't involve an actual bentō box. Instead, six small dishes are placed in a cherry blossom-shaped basket with the food arranged inside the dishes. Each individual serving contains a colourful selection of foods that have been prepared in various ways. There is a raw dish composed of superbly fresh sashimi. Today it's been prepared from yokowa, a species of tuna, and sea bream. It's the height of the season for bamboo shoots. They are boiled in a stock along with butterbur sprouts, sprigs of Japanese pepper, and sea bream roe. The grilled dish is trout, served with yawatamaki, eel wrapped around strips of burdock root, and lotus root cut in the shape of a flower. A slice of omelette and a chrysanthemum leaf lend an extra splash of colour. Usually at restaurants serving kaiseki cuisine, each of the individual dishes is served separately one at a time. But here they're all served at once in this single basket. Elaborate kaiseki cuisine has been combined with the convenience of a bentō. The preparations follow the traditional recipes, but are presented in a more casual style. Bentō and kaiseki share the same principles. This is just a compact form. They are both based on the fundamental principles of Japanese cuisine. The five tastes, the five colors, and the five cooking techniques. They offer a variety of flavors, colors, and cooking techniques. This all comes together in the form of our bentō. Each individual dish is given garnishes that reflect the season. In a formal kaiseki meal, this would be the first course. Served with sake, it features many seasonal ingredients. Sakura sushi, sushi rice wrapped in a cherry leaf. This dish contains numerous other elements that reflect the spring, such as bamboo shoots served with a green dressing made with Japanese pepper leaves. As a visual cue, it's garnished with edible lily bulb that's been shaped into the form of a cherry petal. Araki explains that all these decorations and garnishes are based on the same aesthetic principle. In Kyoto, this is called hannari. It's ornate, but not too elaborate or too gaudy. It has a simple elegance and a beauty that attracts you to it. This is the aspect that we focus on. Meals like this convey a sense of spring, but without being presented in an overly elaborate way. That is the feeling conveyed by this bento meal. In the old days, a bento was just dry grains of rice or cooked rice formed into balls to make it easy to carry. Over the years, numerous other influences have been incorporated to create distinctive new forms and styles.
The word bento doesn't normally conjure up an image of anything quite like this. This kind of food is generally known as kaiseki, which means that it's a multi-course meal and the courses will be brought in order. Because this is served at lunchtime and because all of the dishes are within this one basket, it's referred to as a bento. But very rarely are you going to see a bento of quite this quality. It's almost like looking at a work of art. For that matter, these surroundings, this wonderful traditional architecture, is almost like a work of art as well. But this is truly amazing. The Japanese have a talent for creating entire worlds within very limited spaces. Some examples of this are bonsai, ikebana flower arrangement, and traditional Japanese gardens. And perhaps the same thing can be said about bento as well. And it may be precisely because the space is so limited and clearly defined that so much effort and creativity has gone into developing the contents of the bento. I'll see you again next week. Cheers.
Next edition of Begin Japanology, we look at the life and work of Miyazawa Kenji, a Japanese literary icon who loved the natural beauty of his native Iwate prefecture.